Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises to God, and the prisoners heard them. Don't stir, these guys were in jail for preaching the gospel, but they had enough joy that at midnight they sang praises loud enough, and they prayed loud enough for somebody else to hear. All right, once again, Acts 13, chapter, verse 52. Verse 49 first. And the word of the Lord was published throughout all the region, but the Jews stirred up the devout and honorable women and the chief men of the city, raised persecution against Paul and Barnabas, and expelled them out of their coasts, kicked them out of the city limits. But they shook off, this is what Paul and Barnabas did, they shook it off. They shook it off. They shook it off. Someone gives you rejection or a decline. And then verse 52 says, and the disciples were what? Filled with joy and with the Holy Ghost. People treating us bad, but what? We're full with joy still. And full with the Holy Ghost. So joy is going to work regardless of the situation. Look at, say 15, let's look at 15 and 3, book of Acts. Here's an argument amongst disciples. Can you imagine that? Church folks fussing. Okay, here we go. And certain, let's go to 15 chapter verse 1. Certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, you can't be saved. How many of you heard something like that? Unless you speak in tongues, you can't be saved. Unless you take off those high heels, you can't be saved. Can't be saved. So you hear that all the time. People putting stipulations on what this should be the salvation. Verse 2, when therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas, a certain other of them, should go up to Jerusalem and tell the apostles and elders about this question. And being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenix and Samaria, declaring the conversation of the Gentiles, and they caused great joy in that city. So there it is. That they had a big argument, but on their way to go get the question answered by the elders, they passed by some people, and they had a conversation with them, and they caused everybody to have great joy all over. Just by the speaker. The last one, Acts 8, chapter verse 8. So joy is an important one, and it has to be regardless of what's going on. You still got to be joyful. Acts 8 and 8. And we're going to go back to the lesson after this. Okay, let's go with Acts 8, chapter verse 5. Verse 5. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed to those things which Philip spake, hearing, seeing the miracles he did. Unclean spirits, crying with loud voice, came out of many that were possessed with him. And many taken with palsies and that were lame were what? Healed. And what happened? There was great joy in that city. So joy is independent of what's going on. Joy is something that's manufactured in you by the Holy Ghost, and it doesn't care what's going on around you, it's going to do the same. Gentleness, and our lesson talked about back in Galatians 5:22, it says gentleness, goodness, and faith. Meekness, temperance in verse 23. Temperance. Someone identify, what is temperance? Just losing your temper? More than that, much more. Self-control in every area of life. Self-control. Now, self-control is not something that's here. It's something that is absolutely manifested and it's something that you got to handle on, like driving your car. I'm either going 40 in a 40 mile per hour zone, or I'm going 80. You determine that. You're going to determine that. And the reason why you're probably going to determine that is because there's a highway patrol sitting around the corner, so he's helping you out. But what if there is no highway patrol? I'm going 40 because that's what it says. The streets made me go 40. If I'm in my Corvette and I'm going 120, probably on this street I'm going to kill myself because it's got sharp curves and all this. There's a reason for 40. That's the safest speed. So I'm going to go there. Food. I'm going to eat a plate of food today that's got, probably 50 to 75% vegetables, probably very little meat, probably something that's a beverage that's not containing alcohol, and I'm going to be very good. That's a good plate. I'm going to do good. But I think I'm going to get me two or three more of those. That's out of control. I'm not demonstrating that I'm in control. Even if I wanted two or three more breaks, I'm going to say I don't know. I'm not going to do it. Because I'm in what? Control. Same thing with my wife's lemon meringue pie. I'm only going to eat one in 30 minutes.
Yeah.
I'm only going to eat one in 30 minutes.
First hour.
That's right. I'm just going to eat the one. That's all. Don't make another one. That's just one. So I can stay in control. So then you go over to Romans 12, chapter, verse 1. It talks about showing you're strong enough, showing your strength to be in control. In control. Now, someone read verse 1 through verse 3 for me. Romans 12 chapter. Show me temperance. Okay.
I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service.
Okay.
And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
Okay. And verse 3 says, for I say, through the grace of God, or through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, accordingly as God has dealt to every man the measure of what?
Faith.
So you get into the flesh when you get arrogant, egotistical. I can do it. I got this. I'm under control. I ain't no help. I don't do that kind of stuff like they other folks do. I got it down. And the Bible says you're getting ready for a big fall because your ego is taking you over. And here Romans says, I beg you, I want you to make sure that you prove that you are no longer an alcoholic. Now, Travis, you know what a glass house is? If I say glass house, you know what I'm talking about. Glass house. Travis, go down there and pass out some tracks and witness to those folks coming through that intersection. Well, I have to worry about Travis going in there and getting a fifth before the, just because it was so handy. I mean, some brothers in the church, I can't give that assignment. But you can give it to the ones who have demonstrated that they have victory over all of it. That's just like Kool-Aid for Travis. I'm not going to pay no money for that crap. Dang, but you can give that assignment to the wrong brother. He's going to come to church stumbling on something.
Yeah, they won't say you said it.
Yeah, every make it. Every make it. So that's what Romans 12 and 1 says. I want you to demonstrate, show that you got temperance. Okay, that's what it said. Okay, and verse 25 says, you don't get out of assignment to somebody unless you know that what? If we live in the Spirit, let us also what? Walk in the Spirit. If we live in the Spirit, can we walk in the Spirit? Okay, all right, praise God. Now, and let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. Now, here's the big deal right here. I like this verse. We jump to the 6th chapter, verse 1. Brethren of Galatians, 6th chapter, verse 1. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, in other words, if God backslides, if a Christian backslides, ye which are what?
Spirit.
Restore such a one in the spirit of what? Considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. So let's see how Jesus handles someone bringing to him showing of raw sin. Here it is, dude. Here it is, dude. We call them sinners. Now show us what you're supposed to do with people who you know will backslide in sin. Right out. What are you going to do with them? Well, look at John the 8th chapter. Take John the 8th chapter. St. John 8, chapter verse 1. Here's Jesus going around teaching, and the crowd said to him, Jesus went into the mountain of Olives, and early in the morning came again into the temple. All the people came unto him. He sat down and he taught. That's what he does. He sat down and teach. Verse 3, the scribes and the Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery, caught in adultery. When they had set her in the midst, they said to him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses and the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what sayest thou? This they said, tempting him that they might have to excuse him. But Jesus stooped down, and with his finger wrote on the ground, and so he heard them not. So when they continued asking, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. When they heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the least. Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had lifted up himself, saw none but the woman, said unto her, Woman, where are thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? And she says, No man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go, and do what? Say no more. So, sometimes if you hang around the church long enough, brother or sister, somebody's going to backslide. You're going to be discouraged. You're going to be tired. You're going to be back out there in the world. Who's supposed to restore them? If you consider yourself worth it, spiritual. Consider yourself strong. I'm a drug addict. If you went back out to drugs, but not seeing me over. And let's sound more spiritual. Spiritual means that a person demonstrates that what they believe and the things that make you a strong Christian, he actually practices, he's proven to overcome, and he has the goods to show that, yeah, I'm a spiritual person, and I just don't go to church to get comfort. I go to church also to read the scriptures and get victorious. And it's demonstrated that I'm victorious. Some people go to church just to get comfort with their misery. Get a good word of the preacher. Coming back Monday, same thing. Coming back Wednesday, same thing. Still got my same problems back over there. But this right here is so peaceful over here. How many of you heard something? But I'm still going to walk back into a defeated situation at home. I'm not changing at home, wherever. I'm not changing it. So, but if a person is coming to church, reading the Word, getting the Scriptures in them, doing all those things that make them an overcomer in life, although he had a bad background, now that person can go to that fallen Christian and say, hey, let me help you get that. Yeah. Well, how do you know a person who... that counselor should be. The Bible gives us all the answers that we ever want in life. 2 Peter, 1 chapter. This is how you know a person is overcoming. Right against 2 Peter, 1st chapter. Okay. Now, we're talking about the first 10 verses of that. 2 Peter, 1st chapter. We're talking about the first 10 verses. And then when you get to verse 10, verse 10 tells you the score. Someone just wrote out verse 10.
Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you shall never fall.
If you do this stuff, you got it made. So the shortcut. That's at the end of the book. We was reading the book. What does the last chapter say? If you do these things, you'll never fall. Well, I got to back up from verse 10 all the way back to verse 1 and find out what these things are. Anybody brave enough to read what these things are? 2 Peter, 1st chapter, first 10 verses. That's the answer, right? Anybody? Nobody brave enough? I got to read it. Go ahead. Okay.
Simon Peter, a servant and apostles of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and the Savior Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according to the divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of Him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promise. By these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world just us. And believe this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. Be still. For if these things be in you and abound, they may make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Okay.
But he that lacketh these things and is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure, for ye do these things, ye shall never fall.
So there it is, right there. You got it, something verse, I think it was verse 4. You got to start adding these things. You got to start add this, add that. And start off with knowledge about Jesus Christ. And then verse 5, besides this, give all diligence, add to your faith. Add to your faith. You got faith, but add virtue. Virtue is good character. Show good character. And after you can start showing good character, show some patience. So add to yourself. You know, people say, I've been saved 25 years, but man, I ain't got no patience. You may be mad, I'm chopping your head. I'm fighting. Yeah, coming after you. Yeah, and to godliness, brotherly, what? Kindness. Start being kind to your Christian brothers and sisters. Start doing that. So that's right there. That's the scorecard. 2 Peter, 1st chapter, verse 1 through 10. This is the stuff you got to do. We know you got it going on if you doing this kind of stuff. Now, here's the problem with most saints. The problem in the church is that when a Christian falls, backslides, gets in trouble with sin, most folks will hold their head up and look down there and what? Nose up. Stop socializing. Stop calling. Stop fellowshipping. Because I'm so much better than that, I wouldn't dare do this. So, Brother McClellan, I wouldn't expect to catch him at, I don't even know, David Nightclubs. The dude drop in, corner bar, what have you. But if I ever saw him coming out of that stumbling one Saturday, about midnight, I'd tell him what I'm doing. Here comes I can't get up on Sunday morning. McClellan, I saw you coming out of the dewdrop in corner by drunk as a skunk.
That's not the way that you restore somebody.
Get up here to the altar.
But that's the way that you restore somebody.
It says meekness. And you got to, and you got to be the right person to talk to the other person. You just can't be anybody. And you can't just do it in any kind of manner. All right, praise God. So that's what he's saying, that if you don't watch out, verse 3, for if a man think himself to be something when he is nothing, he does what? Deceive himself. Oh, you thought you all that good. The devil's looking. It's like he was looking with Job. Look at Job. Man, Job got all that going for him. And, oh, Job got all that and all this. And the devil went up there and talked to God and said, God, you know what? If you took away some of that money that Job got, if you make his kids sick, allow his kids to get sick, Job will curse you. If you make Sylvia's son go to the army, she come put him out on the front line, oh, Sylvia will be so mad at you. Take away Shirley's job. Why would she be so mad at you? The devil talks like that, you know. Give her a flat tire. I'm gonna give her. Let me give her a flat tire. I'll show you. Surely ain't coming to church. Let me get my boy to steal a car. Let me get my boy. She ain't thinking about. She ain't gonna call for no ride. Let me get my boys over here and steal a car and all this and all that. They ain't coming to church. And I don't know which day for sure. They ain't showing up. Let me show you. That's what the devil, he talks to God like. And then when the guy who says that, oh, I got to get it, bring it on. Cut your legs out. So this is why Paul says you got to stay in prayer. You got to have all these fruits of the Spirit working for you. And you got to be adding this stuff to yourself daily, working on all this stuff. And then when the temptation comes, you won't fall. That's what he's saying. That's what he's trying to say. Okay, so verse 4. Verse 4 says, let every man do what? Prove it. And then shall he have what? Rejoicing in himself alone. The biggest day to rejoice is when you know that you've overcome alcohol, cigarettes, marijuana, and all that. Oh, nobody parties better than you. Nobody be more rejoicing. You know what I overcome. What a celebration. You don't really need a big celebration. You got it in your heart. When you know that you have got the victory. So every man should bear his what? Own burden. Let him, and this is a profession, of preaching and teaching the gospel. People don't quite understand that, but it is a profession. There is a lot of volunteers, people who do it without pay. Do it without pay. And there's some that make a living from it. It is an absolute profession. And I say, if you do it as a profession and get paid for it, you should be very, very, very good. You should know it from Genesis to Revelation, not what's before. You should know what you're talking about. Not get all mixed up and mix up people and cause people problems if you don't know what you're talking about. You should be good at that. All right. That's William going wrong. So 1 Corinthians 9 and 4. Is it a profession? Now, the Apostle Paul did it, but he could have gotten paid, but he didn't want to get paid for that. He was good at it. But he says, most of my money comes from my stuff and for stuff. I make tents. I'm making sell tents for Paul. But he did realize that it was a profession. 1 Corinthians 9:14. What did he say there?
Even so, had the Lord ordained that they which preach the gospel should live of the gospel.
Okay, so the Lord has ordained, he's made it proper, commanded. It's a part of the profession that if the person preach and teach the gospel to you, they should live off the gospel. In other words, they should make earn a living from it. Earn a living from it. Okay? And then let's look at the vocation of the Apostle Paul, Acts 18, chapter verse 3. His vocation of preaching and teaching the gospel. Acts 18 and 3. I hope I'm going fast enough to go. Okay, this is what happened. Acts 18, chapter, I'm going to verse 1. After these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth. Found certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, lately come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because that Claudius had demanded all Jews get out of Rome. And he came unto them. And because he was of the same craft, see that craft means this is his profession, this is what he does for a living. He stayed with them. They had something in common. What was that same craft? Tent maker. In today's term, I guess it would be a construction worker. Build houses. He bought with them and he worked by their occupation. By their occupation, they were tent makers. And he reasoned in the synagogues every Sabbath. You see, his occupation was tent maker, but every Sabbath he was in the church preaching, teaching. So that goes to show. And there was other scriptures I could show that Paul's attitude was about getting paid for the gospel. Somewhere later, Paul says, I don't need you to pay me for preaching the gospel to you because I make my living by the work. Home building. I would be pretty good at it. That's his profession. This is what he's living in. Okay, now. But if there is someone who has a profession, professionally, preach and teach you the gospel. We know anybody like that? Sure. That's his profession, preaching and teaching the gospel. It says, this is what you do for him. This is the way it's done. Verse 7. Be not what? Let me go in verse 6. Let him that is taught in the word, if you're receiving the teaching, I'm on verse 6 of Galatians, 6 and 6. Let him that is taught in the word communicate or return something to him that teach him in what? All good things. In other words, bring the value back. Bring the value back in monetary form. Bring the value back. Now, here's the deal. If you're not getting any value, it hasn't been worthwhile to you. You know? It didn't bring you up a level. It didn't help you straighten out your house, kids, and everybody else. Matter of fact, I told him what the preacher said, and he got it worse. Told him what the preacher said, and I almost shot me. Oh, well, thanks, sis. I got fired. No. I did what the preacher said, what he instructed me, counseled me to do. Life is so much better. I'm at peace. I'm full of the Holy Ghost. My faith is increasing everything because of what that professional is bringing to my life, pouring into my life. The Bible says, bring back the value. Bring back the value. Okay, that's what he's saying there. And he says, now be not deceived. God is not mocked. Verse 7. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also do what? Reap. Whatever. So if I bring back the value to the professional, delivering to me the spirituality in my life, then it says that you are also going to get value returned back to you. Verse 8, he that soweth to his flesh, shall his flesh reap what? Corruption. Now, verse 7 says, be not deceived, God's not mocked, whatever a man soweth, that he reaps. If you sow to the flesh, reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit, shall the Spirit reap life everlasting. Let us not be weary in well doing. Question to the class is, saints get tired of doing good stuff. I close my eyes. Y'all ever get tired of doing good stuff?
say yeah, because sometimes it doesn't seem like you get any, for lack of a better word, war down
there. Which are blues.
Yeah.
But that was not the case. And if everybody, other than Brother Ron was correct, and the Bible wasted his time, the Holy Ghost did bring this out. What? He wouldn't have said it unless he knew that he was going to get work. I ain't that tired yet. You ain't that tired yet. I'm driving bulls. Running, running, running. Just by the very act of running, you get work. So he would not put that in there unless he knew that you might get tired. Okay.
Doesn't have joy of doing it.
Always. And that's what he's saying. People get tired and they think, well, I'm losing. I'm losing. Get tired. Quit. Give it up. Brother Roger, you walk around a bit sometimes. You got tired the other day. Did you double back? Yeah. That's right, I got you. Yeah, rejuvenate. Don't get tired and quit. This is why those that get tired and quit need the spiritual ones to do what? Bring them back. So he said, don't get tired. It says, you will get tired, but don't what? Quit. Don't quit. Don't quit. Like today, I just lift weights, had muscle, nice to see. All the time. I will get tired sometimes. You've been there. Football practice, 100 degree weather. Tired, dog tired. But brother, make it back to the dorm. What you gonna do the next day? Go right back out. Right back out.
I'm tired.
Get tired. So the Lord knew that you would get tired, but you don't quit when you get tired. You're in the military too, though. Shoot, got tired every day. First day, I was tired of it. First day, they put me on KP. Daddy dogs, pull me out of the line. You, come over here. Go over there. I don't know what I was getting into. Anybody know what KP is?
Yeah.
It's kitchen duty, kitchen police is what they call it. Kitchen patrol. Man, I was washing pots and pans for about 12 straight hours. I did not know that's what I was getting into. Like I said, I was tired of the military the first day. But when you're quit, you wouldn't help. And complaining, that ain't gonna help either. So as we therefore have opportunity to do good unto all men, do it, especially to those who are the households. Real reality. Some people backslide, say somebody's strong enough, they help them out. Let the true spirit of the Holy Ghost work in your life so you can be overcome this. Pay the preacher. Pay the preacher, Cheryl. Pay the preacher.